Good evening, good evening, everyone. Welcome to Memorial Heights Baptist Church. If you're watching online, I'm Pastor Nick Davies. I want to start off with our announcements for the evening. This is a communion service, and if you have not gotten your communion cup, it is out in the foyer right through those double doors in the back. So if you didn't pick one up, go ahead and pick one up. Again, just want to quickly remind you that there are two things that you're going to peel back when we get to that point. We'll remind you guys again, but there's a little plastic piece, a real thin cellophane. You'll peel that back first to get the wafer, and then the second part you'll peel back for the juice. Be very careful when you do that. You don't want juice everywhere. But again, if you did not get one of those, there's more sitting out in the foyer for you to grab. We're continuing to collect for the Annie Armstrong offering. Certainly want to be a part of that in supporting our missionaries. April 4th, which is Easter, we are going to be having a baptismal service in the morning. If you'd like to be a part of that, you can reach out to myself, Pastor DJ, or one of the deacons to get you connected so that we can do that. From Donna Largent, she says, thanking my church for the prayers and cards and the beautiful throw at the sad time my family and I are going through. It is very much appreciated. And they certainly could continue using your prayers for comfort during this time. From Nicole and Gigi, I'd like to say thank you for the flowers that they received this week for Pastor's Wife Appreciation Month. I didn't know that was a thing, but I am glad somebody did, because I do appreciate my wife, and I know DJ does appreciate Gigi as well. Prayer requests, Kathy Jacobs and the family for the continued praying for peace during the time of the passing of Bruce. The viewing is at Adams Family Funeral Home on Tuesday from 2 to 4, and the funeral is at Adams at 11 a.m. on Wednesday. Carolyn and Don Bulger. Carolyn has blood work coming up on the 1st, and then on the 7th, she is actually going to be having her surgery, which is a praise, but a prayer request as well. We want to continue lifting up Bob McCullough, as well as William Rubio, who has gone through colon cancer removal surgery and had part of his lung removed as well. And he has another procedure this coming Friday to see if the colon surgery was successful. We want to continue praying for Doris Hott with the ongoing chemo treatments. Linda Simpson, who's had shoulder surgery. It did go well, but she's continuing to recover, so we certainly want to keep lifting her up. Jamie Rice's aunt, who was in a car accident, and others who are sick, who have lost loved ones, and we want to pray for our first responders and for our nation. So a lot of prayer requests, a lot of things going on right now, but there's a lot of good things to be praising him for. So let's go ahead to the Lord in prayer, and then we're going to start off by worshiping. So let's go to the Lord. Lord God, we thank you for your goodness, for your grace, for your mercy. Lord, even in times of trouble, we know that you are a God that is not far off, but that is near. You are a God that cares for us and loves us. And Lord, there is no better display of the love and care that you have for us than sending your son Jesus to die in our place so that we might have life, so that we might spend an eternity with you, separated from sin, separated from death. Lord God, you are so merciful. While we didn't deserve it, you sent Jesus. And Lord, we thank you for that. We praise you for that. Lord, we lift up each of these requests we have made known tonight. And Lord, even the unspoken that are on our hearts. Lord, we ask that you just bless this time of fellowship with one another. And Lord, may our hearts be entirely focused on you during this time of worship. Lord, we love you. We praise you. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Why don't you stand with me? We're going to start off by singing Power in the Blood. Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power. Not just a little bit, it's a lot of it. It's all the bit powerful. All right. Is it hot in here? This is just me. I'm sweating. All right. Are you washed in the blood? This is another wonderful, wonderful reminder of the blood of Jesus.
Aside the garments that are stained with sin, and be washed in the
turning this over to DJ.
Good job, Nick.
Thank you, Pastor Nick. If you're a visitor, you're joining us online, I'm Pastor DJ. We're so glad to have you as part of our special communion service. We're going to be doing things a little bit differently than we normally do on a Sunday night. We're going to spend a lot of time in worship. We're going to sing some new songs, songs that you're probably not familiar with. And when we sing those, we invite you, as you learn them, to sing with us. But we really are doing them so that you'll focus in on the words of the song, and they'll use them as opportunities to worship from your heart. We're also going to sing some older songs, songs that you know well. And so we invite you, of course, to sing on those as well. But whether it's a song that you know or a song that you don't know, we want all that we do tonight to be focused on Jesus Christ, because he's the only reason that we're here tonight. He's the reason that we have to celebrate. And though we celebrate his resurrection every Sunday, tonight in communion, God has given us something, a very beautiful, powerful picture and illustration of what it was that Jesus did for us when he died on the cross. And so just worship from your heart tonight as we sing these songs together.
He became sin who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from hell. Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. His body the bread, his blood the wine, broken and poured out all for love. The whole and the veil was torn. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all. Blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all our hope is in you. All our hope is in you. All the glory to you, God. The Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel. for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all.
You know, one of the things that the Apostle Paul commanded us to do, and we do it on special occasions like this. We don't necessarily have a specific time devoted for this every Sunday, although we certainly read Scripture during the messages. But it's the public reading of Scripture, and so we're going to do some of that tonight as well. Pastor Nick?
If you have your Bibles, can turn with me to John 12. I'm going to be reading verses 20 through 50. It says this, "And there were certain Greeks among them that came up to worship at the feast. The same came therefore to Philip, which was of Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired him, saying, Sir, we would see Jesus. Philip cometh and telleth Andrew, and again Andrew and Philip tell Jesus. And Jesus answered them, saying, The hour is come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. He that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. If any man serve me, let him follow me, and where I am, there shall also my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor. Now is my soul troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour, but for this cause came I unto this hour. Father, glorify thy name. Then came there a voice from heaven saying, I have both glorified it and will glorify it again. The people, therefore, that stood by and heard it, said that it thundered. Others said, an angel spake to him. Jesus answered and said, This voice came not because of me, but for your sakes. Now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. And I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. Then he said, this he said, signifying what death he should die. The people answered him, We have heard out of the law that Christ abideth forever. And how sayest thou, the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man? Then Jesus said unto them, Yet a little while is the light with you. Walk while ye have the light, lest darkness come upon you. For he that walketh in darkness knoweth not whither he goeth. While ye have light, believe in the light, that ye may be children of the light. These things spake Jesus, and departed, and did hide himself from them. But though he had done so many miracles before them, yet they believed not on him, that the saying of Esaias the prophet might be fulfilled, which he spake, Lord, who hath believed our report, and to whom hath the arm of the Lord been revealed? Therefore they could not believe, because Esaias had said again, He hath blinded their eyes and hardened their heart, that they should not see with their eyes, nor understand with their heart, and be converted, and I should heal them. These things said Esaias, when he saw his glory, and spake of him. Nevertheless, among the chief rulers also many believed on him, but because of the Pharisees they did not confess him, lest they should be put out of the synagogue. For they loved the praise of men more than the praise of God. Jesus cried and said, He that believeth on me believeth not on me, but on him that sent me. And he that seeth me seeth him that sent me. I am come a light into the world, that whosoever believeth on me should not abide in darkness. And if any man hear my words and believe not, I judge him not. For I came not to judge the world, but to save the world. He that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judged him. The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day. For I have not spoken of myself, but the Father which sent me. He gave me a commandment, what should I say and what I should speak? And I know that his commandment is life everlasting. Whatsoever I speak, therefore, even as the Father has said unto me, so I speak."
Philippians 2 says that because Jesus humbled himself, became obedient unto death, even death on a cross, that God the Father has highly exalted him, given him the name that it's above every name. And at the name of Jesus, there is a day coming when every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he's Lord. But we're not waiting till that day to worship him, so we're going to turn our hearts in worship as we sing these next few songs.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven. My sin was great, your love was greater. What can separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin. Heavens are roaring the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. You have no rival, you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name. Above all names, what a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh Lord our God. I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see His wounds, His hands is healed. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears. They laid Him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trample death, where is Your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. Oh, praise the name of the days. We will see.
Going to be reading the entire chapter of John 19, so if you'd like to turn there with me. It says this: Then Pilate therefore took Jesus and scourged him. And the soldiers plaited a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they put on him a purple robe, and said, Hail, King of the Jews! And they smote him with their hands. Pilate therefore went forth again and saith unto them, Behold, I bring him forth to you, that ye may know that I find no fault in him. Then came Jesus forth wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. And Pilate saith unto them, "Behold the man." When the chief priests, therefore, and officers saw him, they cried out, saying, "Crucify him, crucify him." Pilate saith unto them, "Take ye him and crucify him, for I find no fault in him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and by our law he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God." When Pilate, therefore, heard that saying, he was the more afraid, and went again into the judgment hall, and saith unto Jesus, "Whence art thou?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Then saith Pilate unto him, "Speaketh now not unto me? Knowest that thou not that I have the power to crucify thee, and have the power to release thee?" Jesus answered, "Thou couldest have no power at all against me, except it were given thee from above. Therefore he that delivered me into thee hath the greater sin." And from thenceforth Pilate sought to release him, but the Jews cried out, saying, "If thou let this man go, thou art not Caesar's friend. Whoever maketh himself a king speaketh against Caesar." When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he brought Jesus forth and sat down in the judgment seat in a place that is called the pavement, but in Hebrew, Gabbatha. And it was the preparation of the Passover, and about the sixth hour, and he saith unto the Jews, "Behold your king." But they cried out, "Away with him, away with him, crucify him." Pilate saith unto them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." Then delivered he him therefore unto them to be crucified, and they took Jesus and led him away. And he, bearing his cross, went forth into a place called the place of a skull, which is called in the Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him and two others with him, on either side one, and Jesus in the midst. And Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross, and the writing was, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." This title then read, "Many of the Jews, for the place where Jesus was crucified was nigh to the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Greek, in Latin." Then said the chief priests of the Jews to Pilate, "Write not the King of the Jews, but that he said, I am King of the Jews." Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts, to every soldier a part, and also his coat. Now the coat was without seam, woven from the top throughout. They said therefore among themselves, "Let us not rend it, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be, that the scripture might be fulfilled, which saith, They parted my raiment among them, and for my vesture they did cast lots. These things therefore the soldiers did." Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother, and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Cleophas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple standing by whom he loved, he saith unto his mother, "Woman, behold thy son." Then saith he to the disciple, "Behold thy mother." And from that hour the disciple took her into his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, saith, "I thirst." Now there was set a vessel full of vinegar, and they filled a sponge with the vinegar, and put it upon hyssop, and put it to his mouth. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, "It is finished," and he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. The Jews therefore, because it was the preparation, that the bodies should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day, for that Sabbath day was a high day, besought Pilate that their legs might be broken, and that they might be taken away. Then came the soldiers and brake the legs of the first, and of the other which was crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was dead already, they brake not his legs. But one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forth went, came there, out blood and water. And he that saw it bare record, and his record is true, and he knoweth that he saith true, that ye might believe. For these things were done, that the scripture should be fulfilled, "A bone of him shall not be broken." And again another scripture saith, "They shall look on him whom they pierced." And after this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, besought Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him leave. He came therefore and took the body of Jesus. And there came also Nicodemus, which at the first came to Jesus by night and brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pound weight. Then took they the body of Jesus and wound it in linen clothes with the spices, as the manner of the Jews is to bury. Now in the place where he was crucified there was a garden, and in the garden a new sepulchre, wherein was never man yet laid. There laid they Jesus, therefore, because of the Jews' preparation day, for the sepulchre was nigh at hand.
Christ took the bitter cup, his mercy drank it up.
at the cross. At the cross, he came to earth to die, to drink damnation dry. At the cross. Sing hallelujah to the Lamb. Sing hallelujah to the Lamb that was slain. That was slain.
Stand with me as we continue to worship him together.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the blood. See from sense his fear. Sorrow and love flow mingle down. Did as such love and sorrow.
Father, we will spend all of eternity and we will never plumb the depths of your great love for us. Father, we can only today scratch the surface of what it was when you sent your son to die for us, of what he sacrificed on the cross for us. God, when he shed his blood and he died in our place and he took your wrath upon himself, he who knew no sin became sin for us that we might become the righteousness of God. And so, Father, as we turn our hearts now to communion and to your word, I ask God that you would, through your word, prepare our hearts for what we're about to partake in. And God, guide us in these elements, God, as we focus our hearts on the body and blood of Jesus Christ. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. You may be seated. They say that familiarity breeds contempt, and while that's not always true, it is something that we need to guard ourselves against. And so tonight, before we observe communion, we do need to take just a few moments to remind ourselves of what it is that we're doing and what it is that we're not doing. So if you would turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, every time we do communion, we're going to take just a few moments to remind ourselves of what it is that Jesus did for us and what it is he's called us to do in remembrance of him. Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 14, "Wherefore, my dearly beloved, flee idolatry." Verse 15, "I speak to you as wise men, judge ye what I say." Wants us to give special attention and thought to what is about to follow. Verse 16 says, "The cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For we being many are one bread and one body, for we are all partakers of that one bread. Behold, Israel after the flesh, are not they which eat of the sacrifice partakers of the altar? What say I then, that the idol is anything, or that which is offered in sacrifice to idols is anything? But I say that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to devils and not to God. And I would not that ye should have fellowship with devils. Ye cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of devils. Ye cannot be partakers of the Lord's table and the table of devils. Do we provoke the Lord to jealousy? Are we stronger than he?" And turn over with me to chapter 11. Look with me in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 17. "Now, in this that I declare unto you, I praise you not, that ye come together not for the better, but for the worse. For first of all, when ye come together in the church, I hear that there be divisions among you, and I partly believe it. For there must be also heresies among you,
that they which are approved may be made manifest among you. When ye come together, therefore, into one place, this is not to eat the Lord's Supper. For in eating, everyone taketh before other his own supper. And one is hungry, and another is drunken. What, have ye not houses to eat and to drink in? Or despise ye the church of God, and shame them that have not? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you in this? I praise you not. For I have received of the Lord that which I also delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation or condemnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. Wherefore, my brethren, when ye come together to eat, tarry one for another. And if any man hunger, let him eat at home, that ye come not together unto condemnation. And the rest I will set in order when I come. There are five reasons that we observe the Lord's Supper from these verses that we've read tonight. Number one, we do it to unite. We do it to unite. The word communion, the Greek koinonia, it more commonly is translated as fellowship. It really means partnership, community, but community with a goal. It's the partnership that we have because of the blood of Jesus. If you have confessed your sins and trusted in Jesus Christ, his death, his resurrection, for your salvation, for your payment of sins, for your eternal life, then you and I are brothers, sisters. We are one body in Christ. We do it to unite. And so we observe the Lord's Supper not as individuals, but we do it corporately. And we observe the Lord's table not as pastor and deacon and a Sunday school teacher and director and any of that. We come together as one in Christ. Neither Jew nor Greek, neither male nor female. We are all one in Jesus Christ. We come tonight totally equal, one body in Christ. We do it to unite. We also do it to separate. We observe the Lord's Supper exclusively. So let a man examine himself to make sure that we are not divided in our loyalties as we come tonight. When we identify with the cross of Christ, we must reject the false worship of other gods, the gods that he defeated on the cross. And so we come to recognize that we are separate from the world around us. Number three, we come to remember. And so that's why we observe the Lord's Supper ceremonially. This is a sacred thing that we do here tonight, not because it conveys any kind of special grace, but because these elements represent very real, very precious and sacred things. And so we need to be very certain that we're not doing it in an unworthy manner. Now, none of us are worthy to participate tonight. So if you're worried about being worthy, none of us are worthy. But the key is that we don't do it in an unworthy manner. And so there's a very real importance to this. There's a seriousness that we need to bring to the Lord's table. We unite, we separate, we remember, and of course we do it to proclaim the Lord's death until he come. That's why we observe the Lord's Supper visually in the elements of the unleavened bread and the cup of the vine, the grape juice. And we observe the Lord's Supper expectantly. We'll not need to do this in heaven. We'll not need to do this in eternity, in the kingdom, because we only do this until he comes back for his church. And so we're proclaiming our mission, while we wait for him is to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. That no matter who you are or what you have done, if you will repent of your sin and you will trust in the death and the resurrection of the sinless Son of God, Jesus Christ, as the only way to heaven, you can be forgiven. And so, with that, let me remind you that while all brothers and sisters in Christ are invited to partake, this is only for believers tonight. If you're not sure if you're saved, this is not for you to partake in. This is for you to observe. So I'd encourage you to observe with great interest. We would love to talk to you after the service, how you can know that you've been forgiven of your sins through the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's God's grace, but we receive it by faith. So we do this to proclaim the message to ourselves and to the world. And then fifthly, we do it to examine ourselves. This is a time, and we all need these times. We don't do the Lord's Supper every week because I personally don't want it to become ritual. I don't want it to become something that we just do out of habit and that we lose the importance and the significance of it. But we need to make sure that we're doing this on a regular basis so that we take this time, whenever we do it, to really have a self-examination. Where am I in my walk with the Lord? Do I know the Lord, number one? But if I do know the Lord, these Christians that were coming under judgment, under Paul says here in chapter 11, verse 32, the chastening of the Lord, the discipline of a loving father, were doing it because they were not taking this seriously. So do you know that you're saved? 2 Corinthians 13:5. Examine yourself to see whether or not you're in the faith. Test yourself. And then for those of us who are believers in Christ, are you surrendered tonight? None of us are sinless. We're not asking you to make yourself worthy to partake in this, but is there an area in your life that you're not surrendering to God and you're being defiant and you're under conviction and you're under discipline? I would caution you, don't partake tonight. Use this time as a time to get right with God, to observe what your brothers and sisters are doing so that the next time we gather, you can be part of that. Now, I just want to take a few more moments to focus in on the two elements as we think about what we are picturing tonight in the bread and the cup. And so let me remind you, as Paul says here in verses 23 through 26 of 1 Corinthians chapter 11, that when we take the bread, what we are doing is we are remembering and proclaiming his body broken for us. Broken for you. Broken for me. Not just broken for the world in a general sense, although that is true as well, but that we personalize this tonight, that Jesus died for me. That when I struggle with the fact that I'm not perfect, when I struggle with the fact that, as Paul says in Romans 7, the things that I don't want to do, I find myself falling back into them, and how am I still struggling with this after all of these years, that we recognize that God loves us so much that he sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to die for our sins. And he raised him from the dead, and when we trust in Christ, he brings us into his family, and he loves us as the perfect father. None of us are perfect fathers. None of us had a perfect father. Some of us had one that might have been a little closer than the other, but none of us have had or been a perfect parent. But God is our perfect parent. And it's in his love for us that we see his body broken for us. And it's a reminder also that Jesus' death for sin enables our death to sin and all of its consequences. Romans 4:25, Paul says that Jesus was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification. 1 Corinthians 15:3, I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. 2 Corinthians 5:21, he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God. When I take the bread, I'm focusing on the broken body, and it's through his broken body that I, as a Christian, can experience death to sin. And that's going to be a battle in my life, but there's a day coming when the battle will be over, and I'll just experience that in all of eternity. 1 John 3, when we see him, we'll be like him because we'll see him as he is. But that hope should purify ourselves even right now in how we live and how we think. Taking the bread, we remember and proclaim his body broken for us. Taking the cup, we remember and proclaim his blood, the purchase of the new covenant. So much that we could say about the new covenant. We'll talk more about that in depth at a later date. But the thing I want to highlight tonight is that Jesus shed blood cleanses us from all sin and gives us eternal life and access into the promises of the new covenant. Ephesians 2:13, but now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace, who hath made both one, and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace, and that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby. Hebrews 10, I won't read the entire chapter, but a few verses from Hebrews chapter 10, which says this so powerfully. This man, verse 12, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins, forever sat down on the right hand of God, from henceforth expecting till his enemies be made his footstool. For by one offering he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified, whereof the Holy Ghost also is a witness to us. For after that he has said before, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their hearts, and in their minds will I write them, and their sins and iniquities will I remember no more. Now where remission of these is, there is no more offering for sin. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh, and having an high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised, and let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much more as you see the day approaching. We remember his body broken for us. We remember and proclaim his blood that has cleansed us from all sin. And we do this until he comes. Because make no mistake, the risen Jesus Christ is coming again. Jesus said in John 14, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many rooms, there are many mansions. But were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. He's coming back again. One of the disciples said, well, we don't know where you're going. How do we know? How do we get there if we don't even know where you're going? What's the way? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father except by me. So I'd ask you now, as Andy begins to play, we're going to take a few moments. I would ask you to get out your cup and wafer and go ahead and open that up carefully. It can spill a little bit if you're not careful. Just prepare that for us to take together. Once you've gotten that ready, by the way, if there is somebody that got in here tonight without one, you can sneak out real quick and grab one off of the table out in the foyer. I just ask you to bow your head and take a moment to reflect. Do whatever business you need to do with God tonight before you partake of this element. So let a woman examine themselves.
we take the wafer together. Verse 23 again says, "For I have received of the Lord that which I also delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." Now, again, just ask you just to take a moment. Prepare your heart. Focus on what it was that Jesus did for us when he shed his blood. Enables us to be cleansed by the power of the blood from all sin. Eternal life in Christ. After the same manner also, he took the cup. When he had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come." Gospels tell us that when Jesus had instituted the Lord's Supper on that first night, the night on which he was betrayed, that after they were completed, they sang a hymn together. And so this is going to be a time of invitation as we close with this hymn. I would ask you to examine yourself even as we sing this song. If you need to come and pray at the altar's open. If you need to speak with the deacon as we close, we're here for you. We can meet with you during the song, after the song is over. But let's stand together as we close and celebrate the victorious Son of God.
Man of sorrows, what a King, all
What a Savior you have sent to us in your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, thank you for the blood. Thank you for the body of Christ dying on our cross in our place. So, Father, may we this week, as we as a church around the world have set aside time to focus in on the triumphal entry and on the Passion Week, God, may we have a renewed sense of the greatness of our God in his love for us in the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We love you. We thank you. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You are dismissed.